American University in Bulgaria.
My real pleasure to introduce to you Metodi Nikolov, who is working for FinAnalytica and is one of the person for building this Cognity software. The major objectives of this software is to help financial risk management, be more narrow, but not in general risk management. If you are going to cross the street on red light, probably they will not solve your problem. Okay.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. So, as Professor Christozov says, my name is Metodi Nikolov, and I'm here representing FinAnalytica. I'll be talking about general financial risk management and the way we deal with it in FinAnalytica in building the software. Our software, which is called Cognity, that's the name on the board. When Professor Christozov came to us and asked us to do a general overview of the system in terms of data modeling, data mining techniques, we naturally jumped to the occasion because we would really love to share everything we do with you guys, just so you know of us. We don't have that much of exposure in Bulgaria, to be honest. Most of our clients and dealings are outside the country. And today, in these two lectures, we'll...
Just yeah, absolutely. The same case here.
Absolutely. The first lecture for today, we're going to do an overview of the company, the system, what is financial risk management, as Professor Christozov said. We'll define more or less what are the problems that a system for risk management needs to solve. We're not going to go too much into the details of how we solve it. We leave that for another lecture. And we'll have some odds and ends around risk management as well. The second lecture for today, we're going to define basically what data is needed by one such system for risk management. And you can view it as a crash course in financial risk and financial mathematics and modeling in general. I just wanted to be sure that we're on the same page in terms of definitions of data and financial models and what data is used for what model and where it all comes together. So the agenda for the first lecture, as I said, who we are, what is risk management, and what are the problems for risk management, and the boasting slide. Basically, we have a few awards for best market risk solution provider. We narrowly missed the 2011 one. We were second place there, actually. We've been mentioned in a lot of news outlets, and we have 6 US patents approved and probably double that pending currently. So we are very heavy on, and our main sales pitch, if I can use that, is that we are very quantitative. We use a lot of statistics, a lot of data mining algorithms, and we're not just providing our clients with some formulas in Excel that they can use. We're providing enterprise-wide solution, and it's quite technical. We'll see that next week, actually. We have over 90 direct clients and over 250 through partners that we have gathered. And there are a lot of interesting names here: Aon Hewitt, BNP Paribas, PricewaterhouseCoopers, Aviva Investors. There are a lot of names here that are worth mentioning in terms of what we deal with. And the types of clients that we support are quite diverse. hedge fund, pension funds, large banks with investment units and so on. Almost anyone who deals in market risk can more or less use the system and can benefit from it. Now, in terms of where we are, we have roughly 50 people here in Bulgaria. This is the research and development, quantitative analysts such as myself, developers who actually write the software. It's in Java, in C, all kinds of technologies. We have offices in London and we have offices in New York, where the sales and operations are mostly based. So, enough about us. Now, what is risk management in finance? Basically, risk management is the process of identification, analysis, and mitigation of potential risk for a portfolio. We'll get to what a portfolio is. I'm sure you basically understand it, but I have the definition as well. So, the three things are important here: identification, so we need to see where the risk is coming from; analysis, not only which positions contribute to our risk, but which drivers actually contribute to that as well, and ways to actually mitigate the risk, to reduce it so that things are not that bad as they seem. There are different types of risks that a portfolio is exposed to. Market risk, which is what we'll be talking about in these lectures and what the Cognity system is about, which is changes in the value of the portfolio given price changes of the different financial assets, financial investment. Credit risk. For credit risk, we basically have the possibility or the probability of defaulting, let's say, a given bond. That would be a credit risk. Operational risk is another type of hazard. It's not so much for a portfolio, rather a whole organization, where human errors in different procedure, computer bugs, if you like, that kind of things, if they lead to losses, that's operational risk. We'll not be dealing with that. So, this basically is what risk management is all about from a bird's-eye view. It's not that much into the details, but before we actually get to the details, I wanted to make sure that we're on the same page in terms of what a portfolio is, because this will be a main topic of our discussions here. And a portfolio is basically a connection of financial instruments. You can think of a collection of stocks. You own 20 different companies through their stocks. That would be your portfolio. Of course, you need to know not only which companies you invested in, but how much you invested in. So these two things are inseparable. For stocks, the number of contracts is enough for you to know how much you invested in a given portfolio. But for a bond, you want to look at the face value of the bond. For different contracts, you might want to look at its nominal and all the rest. If these words are not really familiar with it, with you, we'll discuss it next time, next lecture hour, because I really want to make sure that everything is up to that. So, the portfolio is dependent on the price of its constituents. Is kind of saying almost nothing. Of course, it's going to change when the value of IBM goes up. Your whole portfolio is going to go up. You're going to own more money in terms of that. So the level, the amount of money invested in your portfolio depends on the prices of the instruments. And this changes due to the price movements of stocks is what is inherently in risk management. When you buy and sell your instruments, buy and sell stocks, and that's trading activity, and the value of your portfolio can also change based on that. But that's not really what we'll be after. What we are going to be after is risk. But in order to see how we can identify it, mitigate, and analyze it, we need a good working definition of what risk is. No. I'm starting with actually comparing it with uncertainty. And the reason for that is in general, in the whole market as such, people tend to misunderstand risk and uncertainty. Uncertainty is not really risk. The two words are sometimes synonymous. I'm sorry, they're related, but they're not synonymous at all. So, investment or market risk is related to the unknown future monetary loss to which an investment is exposed. So, you're looking only at your losses. The risk for you is how much you're going to lose. Well, it's the money that's on the line, the money that could, today they're in your pocket, tomorrow they'll not be in your pocket. That's your risk. So it's asymmetric phenomena. Basically, you're not really that concerned with what would happen tomorrow in terms of gains. I can gain $100 or I can lose $100. So my loss is $100. But I can, in another possibility would be to gain $200. That has no bearing on your risk as such. You're still at risk of losing of $100 loss. The uncertainty is a symmetric notion. You have the usual, we'll see in another slide, but the standard deviation, which is, you all know what standard deviation is. Okay. It's a symmetric around the mean. It doesn't take into consideration what is a loss, what is a gain. So it only looks at the positive or negative deviations from the expected price. So risk is not really, so uncertainty is not really a risk. And I have a thought experiment here to play with you, basically. Well, if you flip a fair coin, you will win one left if heads and three if tails. So, is there a loss here? No, you always win. It's just a matter of how much you're gonna win. You don't stand to lose anything from playing this game. So you're always in an advantage. You will always play this game. So the only thing that here is uncertain is how much exactly you're gonna win. And there is no loss here. And to make it a loss game, something that you can actually lose, you have to give me $1 if tails. So I'll give you one if heads, you give me one in tails. That's your loss. Now, to measure uncertainty, people basically go to dispersion measures. And in general, there are a lot of them in statistics. The standard deviation, mean absolute deviation, semi-standard or upside or downside standard deviation. This here thing basically is the maximum between the value in the, let's have this here. So just the standard notation, this would be the maximum between x and zero. This would be the minimum between x and 0, which basically makes it if x is less than 0, I guess. I'm sure that you know these guys, so don't worry about it that much. So these two, they are symmetric. So that we can't really use them for risk. But people actually have do this, and they're measuring their portfolio risk in terms of the standard deviation of the portfolio, but not so much. That's the uncertainty around the mean. The upside and downside standard deviation, they're asymmetric. So looking at only the downside standard deviation, which is basically the standard deviation of values of x which are below the mean kind of serves our purpose, to be honest. But there are different problems with that. And we'll come to that in a moment, why it's not okay. Now, the dispersion measures are such, they have certain properties which are nice to have in terms of what we deal here. Positive homogeneity, basically if we multiply the random variable with x by a constant, non-negative, it will come out in front of that. It's positive. So for all x, this is non-negative, and it's strictly positive if x is a non-constant or it's actually a proper random variable. We have this very nice property of additivity here, that the dispersion measure of the sum of two random variables is not more than the dispersion measures of the two variables. And why is this a nice property? It's something that we really want to see. It's linked with the investment process. Say you buy one stock of IBM and one stock of Apple. Now, intuitively, you should not bear the same risk as owning only, basically the portfolio of the two things shouldn't be more risky than the risk of each and every of these stocks. You have what is called a diversification effect in your portfolio. Now, IBM and Apple maybe not the best examples for stocks that are diversifying. Basically, they are in the same industry. If they go up together, that's more probable than they going one up and the other one down, where the diversification effect will come into place. But if you take, for example, an oil company and chip manufacturer, there is not such a great relationship between those two, and you get a larger diversification effect. So this is something that people usually like to see in their risk measures. Now, translation invariance, it's a very interesting property which basically states that if you add a constant, no matter what this constant is, it just needs to be a real number, to a random variable, you will not change the dispersion of that. Now, for financial instruments, can you guess what a constant would be? Anyone?
Something that doesn't affect.
Exactly. And that would usually be cash. So you have $100, you invest 50 of that in your stock, you leave 50 as cash. You actually own just $50. And the risk of your portfolio would be the same as just $50 worth of stock. Basically, this is what translation invariance would tell you. But do you stand the same risk if you have $50 worth of stock and $50 cash, as if only you had invested $50? Actually, no. Because if the stock loses $5, your investment loses $5, let's say, the $50 basically act as a cushion. You're not so much exposed to that. And I'm continuing the thought experiment here and extending it with another player, basically a friend of yours. He really wants you to gamble, and he thinks that you don't gamble enough, which is a bad thing, but financial instruments basically sometimes can be viewed as gambling. And he wants to give you two laughs no matter what, just for you to play one game. This is the same as having cash in your portfolio. Even if you lose the coin flip, I lose one laugh, he will still give you two laughs, and you are one laugh ahead. So there is no risk. And this payoff, which is external in a sense to the game, mitigates the risk, and actually there is no risk here. And so basically the translation invariance that we have for dispersion measures breaks this. So we're not seeing this effect, we're not lowering the risk measure with the constant. So basically here we mentioned one name, which is Harry Markowitz, and he was the guy who recognized first the relationship between risk and reward. And when we get to portfolio optimization, he was the guy who actually made the first portfolio optimizers for equities. But his main contribution is to actually recognize that in order to get return, you actually have to have risk. There is no way for you to get something without you being exposed to losing something. So if you have zero risk, then you most probably have zero return. Or if there is some return for zero risk, the market is not efficient and the market players would all flock to this way of optimizing portfolios and building portfolios, and this would just negate everything and we'll end up with zero return for zero risk. And the way he did it was basically using the standard deviation as a measure of risk. So the whole idea of talking about dispersion measures basically comes from that. We wanted to have something to actually measure risk, because we already said what risk is. Risk is losing money from the portfolio, but how do you measure it? What is the way that you're going to quantify two different ways of losing? Because you can lose from one position or you can lose from another position, and everything comes into a portfolio, so you actually want to measure it so you can actually do something about it. And he used standard deviation, but actually he suggested that downside deviation should be used, looking only at the losses that are below the expected return. But as we saw, that's not really enough for us. Now, one thing, I don't have a watch on me, so if we start to get to the end of the lecture, just tell me. And one thing I probably should have mentioned before, if you have any questions, please don't hesitate at all to ask. I actually prefer we have a discussion as such, rather than just going through the slides. So, we need a better measure for risk than what dispersion measures can give us. So, and people started looking for such measures, and one that basically was popularized in the late 1980s by an investment for JP Morgan, and the whole industry started using it, the financial industry. And actually people went in and, I mean, regulators went in and defined what capital reserve a bank should own to mitigate their risk based on this measure. So it's quite prevalent. Almost everybody uses it. And it is defined as the minimum level of loss at a given sufficiently high confidence level, either 95 or 99%. Some people look at 99.99% over a predefined time horizon. So it's quite natural to what we've been discussing so far. You have your portfolio and you want to know what amount of money you stand to lose over the next day. You have an investment horizon of 1 day or 1 week or 1 month. So it depends on your needs and what kind of a player you are. And the risk measure value at risk, or VAR, is what we will tell you about it. So I have here the example that it's more mathematical way to put it, but 1 minus epsilon times 100%. Think of epsilon 0.1 for 99%. Sorry, 0.01. So the one-day VAR of your investment is X. X is $1 million, for example. This means that over the next day, the investment may lose more than X with probability epsilon. So we have a very small probability of losing more than the value at risk. To put it in more numerical terms, if you have $100 invested and your one-day VAR is, say, $5 at confidence level 99%. This means that if you do 100 realization of tomorrow, in only one of those realizations, you will lose more than $5. And in the other 99 realization, you will lose less than $5. So that's kind of the floor you're gonna, with certain probability, of course, and you will not lose more. Your portfolio will not fall below that floor. The mathematical way to see it or to define it is this minus here is that the whole thing is positive, but we have the probability of your investment being less or equal than X, and we want this probability to be larger or equal to epsilon, and we look at all those X's and we find the infimum of this set, and when we take the infimum we put a minus sign here, so the whole thing looks like a VAR. So and X here are the possible losses for your portfolio. Now, funny thing is that there is actually a better way to say it, to write it down mathematically. If, it's not a small if actually, but, no, sorry, it's a minor if. If F minus 1 of X is the cumulative distribution, the inverse cumulative distribution function of your X. So we now get into a territory where X has a statistical or probability distribution. We actually model it in some way, say a normal Gaussian distribution, a student T distribution, or fat tail. We'll talk about this next week. But when we have the actual probability model of our losses and we inverse the cumulative distribution function, taking epsilon, the value at epsilon of this function will be exactly our VAR number. So this basically makes the whole calculation of VAR very easy for certain probability distributions. The Gaussian distribution is very easy to work with. I'm sure you've done a lot of work with the Gaussian distribution, and while you have to do it this numerically, when you actually do it, you find out that it's coefficient times the standard deviation of X, if X is a Gaussian distribution. And you have to move it a little bit with the mean of the distribution, but it basically allows very easy calculation if you assume the Gaussian distribution. But there is a point here that I would like to make. We spent a little bit of time talking about what is loss and what is uncertainty. And VAR is rather a nice measure of loss, of risk. It's not only about uncertainty, so it's getting us there. But if you plug a normal distribution, a Gaussian distribution here in this formula, you actually end up with the standard deviation of the variable. So even though you use a better risk measure for measuring your risk, if you use models such as the Gaussian, which is symmetric around its mean, you still end up with a symmetric measure of risk, which got us back to square one. We didn't improve anything on that. It's a point that we're going to stress a little bit more when we actually start discussing data and statistical models and whatnot, but I just wanted to make sure I mention it here. Even if you have the best risk manager in the world, VAR is not one of that, but even if you have the best risk manager in the world, if you supply it with a probability model which is symmetric, you're still going to end up with something which resembles standard deviation. So you're not better off using VAR for normal compared to just using standard deviation for normal. It's a fine point, but now VAR really is downside risk measure, so it looks at losses, but unfortunately there are cases where the sum of two variables can have a larger value at risk than the sum of the respective variables VAR. So we don't have sub-additivity for VAR. We don't have the diversification effect. And this is quite unreasonable for some people. And some research was put in there, and people came up with actually the four main properties that a good risk measure should have. And all risk measures that have these properties, they are called coherent risk measures. And these are the coherent risk measures are the good ones. So we have sub-additivity, which VAR doesn't have. We have positive homogeneity, basically at zero it's zero, and if we multiply by a positive constant lambda, this lambda can leave the risk measure. We have monotonicity, which basically states that the risk of y is less or equal to the risk of x whenever y is larger or equal to x almost surely. So what this means is that if we order the risk variables in terms of their values, and we have that one variable is always less, almost surely. You know what almost surely is? Okay, everywhere that matters. Okay. You can think it as this almost surely basically means that this property is true everywhere that really matters, and we don't really care about where it doesn't. It's not true. So if we order the investments, the risk of the larger one will be less than the risk of the smaller one. Think of it is in this way. Take a Bulgarian bank and a US-based bank. Almost surely, the losses that the Bulgarian bank can sustain on the stock market will be larger than the losses of the US-based bank. The Bulgarian bank loses 5%, the US bank loses 1%. So we always have this thing that the Bulgarian bank loses more money on the market than the US-based bank. So we have this thing here. What we want from our risk measure is to show that the risk of the US-based bank is less than the risk of the Bulgarian bank. Naturally. We want to make sure to be able to measure risk nicely. This is something that we want. And the last property, this invariance here, which we already discussed a little bit, if we add something to the losses, x is a loss, so we add something to that, we want to reduce the risk measure with the same thing. So in our thought experiment, the two legs that your friend gives you, they are reducing your risk. So even though he gives it to you, so we have the plus sign, but that reduces the risk, so we have the minus sign here. And so these four properties basically define a coherent risk measure. And it turns out that there's a very easy way to get a coherent risk measure out of VAR, in some sense, so we can extend the VAR. and this is something that it's quite useful. So it's called average value at risk. Some people call it conditional VAR or expected shortfall. It's different terms for the same thing, but basically you take the VAR and integrate it from 0 to epsilon. So once again, we have a confidence level, which is 99%, so epsilon would be 0.01. You integrate the VAR from 0 to epsilon and scale it back with 1 over epsilon. Now, the way this works is that it looks at the losses beyond the VAR. So you take the various VAR numbers from full confidence, so you want to know what with full probability what is the possible way, the maximum up to, let's say, 5% or 1% 95 or 99% confidence level, and you sum them up. Integration is a way of saying sum. So you sum them up and you scale it back with the interval you're summing over. So you're not left with only the VAR. The example I gave you, you have $100 investment, you stand to lose, your VAR is $5 over the next day with 99% confidence. And I gave you this example. If from 100 realization, only one would be the loss would be larger than $5, right? So the VAR is 5. But how large? How large is that loss? Is it the same to you if you lose $6 or 60 out of the $100 investment? I would venture to say no. You want to know how large that loss is. If the expected loss over the VAR, let's say $6, that's fine. I mean, it's not more than the VAR. I don't stand to lose that much. But if it's 60, wow, that's more than half the portfolio. I have to do something about it. So it's large. Now, I already mentioned something like this, but we already saw. There's something like this here. Anyway, we already saw that the VAR actually represents the inverse cumulative distribution function when we assume certain probability model. And if that probability model is continuous in this interval from 0 to epsilon, it doesn't have to be continuous over the whole 0-1 interval. It just needs to be continuous somewhere around here. You can actually write the average VAR as expected return, as an expected value, conditional on the fact that the random variable actually is less than the VAR number, the quantile. Yeah, quantile is a good word, which I forgot to mention. You all know this probably, that quantile function is the same as inverse cumulative distribution function. So you actually can write it in terms of a conditional expectation here. And this really gives you the expected number of losing more than that. And I just want to mention something here really quickly. We'll deal with this a little bit more next week, but let's say you observe any realization of your loss. How to see where the VAR is? Well, you take, let's see what the English word for this was. Well, you order them, basically. You order the losses realization in increasing order. So you have this thing here. X brackets 1 is less than equal to X brackets 2 and so on. So you order them. And you, out of this, your var number will be somewhere, let's say, here. Your actual var number would be X brackets 5. It has to be one of the realization for the loss. You cannot, it cannot be something else. Well, it actually depends on how you do it, but let's say the var is X brackets 5. This, if you look at the 95% var and n is equal to 100, this would be exactly the number. This thing here basically tells me, take the expectation of X when X is less than the var. So if var is equal to this thing here, then I need to take the expectation of X1, X2, X3, and X4 with brackets. And taking an expectation of a given set of variables is easy. You just take, you sum them up and divide by 1 by 4. Okay? So, it's very, so to speak, easy step to get from var to expected tail loss. It's not a huge computational burden to get from one to the other. Something else here. Some words about the size and structure of a given portfolio. Now, basically, with the last slide, we kind of finished our introductory session into what is risk and how to measure it. We defined risk, we defined how we measure it. We prefer to use average VAR. And that's fine. Every risk system that tries to measure risk would have something like this. Definition of what's loss, definition of how we measure it, and so on and so forth. But now we get into, so to speak, the problems that a risk system is defining to solve. I mean, what is the scope of a risk measure, risk system, sorry. And what are basically the problems that one such system needs to solve? And the first such problem that we're gonna discuss a little bit is, it has more to do with databases and how you actually get the client portfolio into the system. Because every one of our clients usually invests in all kinds of different stuff. Even if they're, let's say, a hedge fund, they may have one portfolio which is a global macro portfolio, which would basically mean that they invest in almost everything that's tradable. Another portfolio would be only stocks. So there are very various instruments that a client needs to basically import into the system and see risk for. Be it stocks, bonds, future options. We'll learn a little bit more about this a little bit later on. And one of the issues I usually find in when I deal with clients is sometimes they are a little bit set in the ways they do certain things. For example, when they look at stocks, they like to use a risk measure, which it's not really at all a risk measure, of beta. So they calculate the linear coefficient of the stock to the market and call that coefficient beta, and they basically order and look at their stocks only through this linear coefficient. If it's larger than one, okay, this stock is more risky than the market. If it's less than one, oh, it's more conservative, less risky than the market. Which is, as we saw, not really a good way to look at risk, but some people do it. And the problem becomes that the same client, when they talk about their bond portfolio, they look at something completely different. There is no definition of beta for a bond. Even the most conservative clients don't know something like this. And for example, for bonds, they look at duration, which is a property of the bond that basically tells you how long it will take you to get your money back. If you invest today, in 3 years, for a duration of three, this means that in 3 years I'll get my money back. And they order and look at their bonds in terms of this. So, problem happens when you want to combine the two portfolios. So you have your equity portfolio, your bond portfolio, you combine the two, and what happens? What is the way you want to look at risk now? Is it beta? Is it duration? Not so much. This is where we come in, basically the quantitative analyst, and we explain more or less the same thing I explained to you so far. What is risk? We quantify it in this way using ETL and VAR and so on. And they kind of get it. And But it's still a problem of putting everything together. Not only the report, because finally we want to show something to our clients. You have your portfolio and this is the risk, and so on and so forth. But the system actually needs to be able to handle all of the equities and all of the bonds. So you have a huge database sitting besides the system, below the system, which serves the definition of stocks, the definition of bonds, and all the other ones. And these portfolios can actually become quite large. For example, what I have here, two indices, which are special kinds of portfolios that the exchanges or some people like S&P or Dow Jones or Barclays, they define in some sense, and they publish numbers for the whole portfolio, how its present value moves around, and people use it as a benchmark. If this portfolio returns 5%, because it's so large, no one is actually governing it, it's a fixed formula for the weights, I'm a good manager, I should be able to bring 6%. And this is something that they based their remuneration. Can I beat the benchmark? Yes, I can. And if I beat the benchmark, I want to see more money in terms of my bonus on the end of the year. The problem for a risk management system is that the bond benchmark is 15,000 separate bonds. And because you want to analyze the client's portfolio, the manager's portfolio, which is, let's say, 50 or 60 bonds or 500 or 600 bonds, against the return and the profit and loss profile of the benchmark, you actually have to model the benchmark as well. And there are 15,000 bonds in there. So it actually becomes a kind of a problem to handle so many bonds, so many financial instruments in such a bond. I mean, you can imagine that it's one thing in terms of speed and memory for a computer system to estimate something that is 50 bonds and something that is 1500. And this is for bonds, which is actually a much more data intensive financial instrument than a simple stock. A simple stock is very easy to model, but still, even a well-known equity index, S&P 500, is 500 separate stocks. So again, you have to bring that in memory, do some calculation on that, do something about it, and then preserve. Present result. And most of our clients actually want to see something else. They don't have only one portfolio. If you have only one portfolio, you're kind of a small player. You usually have 10, 15, 500 portfolios, depends on how large you are. And they want to see risk coming from each and every one of those portfolios on a separate basis, but it's much more meaningful to them and for senior management to look at whole risk for the whole enterprise. So you combine one manager with S&P 500 benchmark, with another manager that have his own portfolio, let's say 100 positions, and he has a separate benchmark, and then another manager. And actually, at some point, you can look at in excess of 100,000 positions. So it's quite large enterprise portfolio, and you have to model it, and you have to do it fairly quickly, actually. If they give you their portfolios at the end of the business day, they actually want to see the risk when they get to work the next morning, 6 o'clock. So it has to be something somewhat fast. Now, what they want to see actually from those portfolios? Now, when you look at your portfolio, there the first thing you want to know, the more easy question to answer actually, is what was my performance during the past year? So you have your stocks portfolio for the last 12 months. You want to see how the portfolio looked like. For example, it starts somewhere around here. We have time here, T minus 12. You start somewhere around here, and it went something like this. And this is lower. So they want to see this, but it's not really enough to give them one graph and say that's it. They want to know something more. They want to know which were the positions that most contributed to this. Where did I gain most? Where did I lose the most? Which market segment? Did I invest too much in technology stocks or too little compared to my benchmark? And this is what the industry usually call performance attribution. And the data that you need for this kind of analysis is basically prices for the instruments and positional information. Now, prices for the instruments, it's not so difficult to obtain. I mean, the exchanges provide this. We're going to see in next lecture what they provide and how to use it. But I just want to stress a little bit, this is for the instrument. And the reason for stressing it will become apparent when we start discussing levels for risk factors, risk drivers, because there is a distinction between a financial instrument and a risk driver. It's probably a little bit difficult to grasp right now. I hope to make it perfectly clear during the next hour. And when you have this graph, you basically need to know the prices on each of these dates here and what was the position level information for the portfolio. So if we go back to the previous example, we have 100,000 positions, and we need to know it for each date during the past year. So this piles on and on the amount of information that needs to be stored and be able to analyze. And basically, you need to be able to explore the data visually, numerically. So we're talking about different graphs, different statistical information, such as expected return, standard deviation, so on and so forth. VAR, of course, ETL, different betas, catch funds, and so on and so forth. And you presented this in a nice way so that people can understand it in terms of graphs, box plots, and all that. I'm going to do a separate demo on that next time. Now, that's not the only way that you can look at past performance, this portfolio attribution, because portfolio attribution, performance attribution, it boils down to financial instruments and how they, which one of those beat the market or beat the benchmark, which did not, and so on. But a different way to actually look at it is that is for, well, looking at interdependence between assets. But you have to be smart about this, because here we actually start to deviate a little bit about doing it for whole portfolio. For looking at the covariance matrix, you actually have to carve out a little bit some of the positions. You only want to look at equity information, for example, only stocks. The reason for that is a bond, for example, it's an expirable instrument. It has an end date. After that end date, you can no longer trade it. It's not even in existence anymore. So at its maturity date, the issuer of the bond, the company that issued it, or the government that issued it, they repay the money, and the bond ends. So there is this life expectancy of certain instruments that needs to be taken into account, and there are certain mathematical difficulties if you try, for example, to estimate a covariance matrix based on the returns of bonds. It's not something that you really want to do. For equities, though, it's quite natural, and this is something that clients and users of a risk management system want to see. The covariance matrix of a set of equities. Now, of course, we're not talking about huge set of equities anymore, because you want to be able to observe the information. It can be both numerically, the actual numbers of the correlation matrix, or graphically. There is a ellipsis plot, which is kind of nice, actually. It plots a perfect circle for a correlation of zero. And as the correlation grows, you actually start. So you have something like this. This would be rho zero. And when the correlation start to grow, you actually plot an ellipsis like this. This would be for rho 0.75. So it's a positive like this. It gets more narrow as the correlation grows. And you actually plot something like this. Not so bad, but yeah, something like this, when the correlation is negative. And you actually get a nice visual representation of the correlation matrix in this sense. You don't really have to look at the numbers to see that two equities are very dependent, linearly dependent. You just look at something that starts to resemble a straight line. And people actually look at this, and the nice thing about the covariance matrix is that there is so much information in there, and you can actually have different ways to extract that information. I'm talking about principal component analysis, statistical factor analysis. Have you guys actually, I think this somewhere around statistics, multivariate statistics, or even this course, the principal component analysis was probably mentioned. Okay, excellent. So you know what I'm talking about. You take the correlation or covariance matrix, and then you decompose it into the principal components factors, and you see which are the main drivers there. Can I extract three factors that would explain 90% of everything the covariance metric has, which would be very nice. And the funny thing is that there are different ways to actually look at the underlying data, because there are different ways to actually estimate the covariance metrics. I'm sure you've heard for robust statistics, which is a way to remove outliers from the data. And there is a huge difference between the covariance matrix coming from the classical way of estimating method of moments covariance matrix and a robust one. We'll discuss a little bit more further on. But if you decompose this into principal components, you're probably going to see different factors loading on different equities or different risk drivers. So there is information there you can actually extract. The same goes for another model that goes for dependence, and it's a linear dependence model, basically a factor model, linear regression. But you have something like this is a simple linear regression with one factor, and y would be the return of a stock, and x would be the return of some index or some other exogenous factor for that. And you actually want to see this beta and this alpha. And there are a couple of ways to actually estimate the parameters as well, depending on what you want to assume for the residual here. You can also assume something Gaussian, where method of moments or maximum likelihood based on the normal distribution would work nicely, but usually it's not so well behaved as to be Gaussian. So you assume either some robust regression statistics method of estimation or something else, and you'll get two different set of estimates. And you actually want to compare them, because comparing them also gives you something to say about this too. And the usual way would be if you take y here and x here, the usual picture we observe is something like this. So we have a bulk of the data somewhere around here, and the standard linear regression gives us something like this. But then you have some points so here, where this guy return much more than this guy, or somewhere around here as well. Now, the robust line would probably looks a little bit more like this. Sorry. In the presence of this would be least squares. Robust would be this one. So if you have something like this, which can be thought of a little bit as outliers, the robust regression would still be something somewhere around here. These squares would be affected by this, and it's a matter of preference, so to speak, what you would like to model. Is it the bulk of the data here, or all of the data, and you actually want to have influence from these points? FinAnalytica and Cognity's approach is to allow these two as preferences, but we also have, we kind of strong in non-Gaussian models, FETEL models. This is something we'll discuss a little bit more in detail next week, but points like this, they're in the tails of a distributional model, and they don't follow a Gaussian distribution. And if you use a Gaussian distribution to model this, you're actually underestimating or overestimating. You're basically having your risk wrong. And you don't want to be wrong about this. Since I mentioned risk, another of the problems that the risk management system, of course, has to solve for is risk estimation. And risk estimation and forecasting is basically quantifying the risk of the portfolio. So far, we looked at past performance, how my portfolio performed during the past year without going further. So the end date is today. We talked about some dependence, but then again, though that dependence is still in the past. We're not predicting anything for the future. And both VAR and ETL, they are kind of looking at what would happen for tomorrow. So the loss was the monetary loss gain of the portfolio over the next day or the next week. So you have estimation and forecasting of that risk. And the main question here, of course, is what is those risk over the next month, day or week? And once you get that number, let's say my portfolio has risk of 3% ETL over the next day. Okay, that's great. But where is it coming from? Is it from equities? Is it from bonds? Is there diversification effect in my portfolio? How large is this diversification effect? What is actually driving my risk? Is it my equity exposure or my bond exposure, which is a little bit different from just diversification? And probably the most high level question is what can I do to lower that risk? Can I, if I make these and these changes to my portfolio, will my risk get reduced? And these are, of course, major problems that a risk management system needs to handle. And lastly, it's the question not so much for analyzing the risk, but more about mitigating it. The question becomes, is there a way to invest which would have the least amount of risk? And the way we usually do it, I mean, you can start from the risk management part here and make some changes, lower your risk, then make some other changes, still get a lower risk. There are ways for the system to show you which are the positions that contribute the most, so you can actually lower them and increase other that diversify, and you get a reduction in risk. But the usual question, the usual thing to think about is, this manual work. You have to see the portfolio, make some change, implement the change, and so on and so forth. Can the system actually do this automatically? The answer usually is yes. Kind of depends on the actual portfolio. It's best to use equities here or stocks. But there is a way for you to define what you want to get, least risky portfolio, or the least risky portfolio that has a certain amount of return to it, and the portfolio optimizer would actually solve that problem for you. It will juggle along the weights of the different instruments and present to you with a portfolio that would satisfy your constraint and be the optimal in a certain sense. And sometimes people use a multivariate factor model, something like this, but with more axes, where the actual axes are different factors for different market. So X1 would be the equity market, X2 would be something which is governed by the fixed income market, X3 would be the commodity market, and so on. And they would actually define their constraints so that they don't get too much exposure to any of these markets. And that's actually a nice optimization problem. Can I have a portfolio that is equally exposed to every one of these? It's a nice problem that we can solve. And of course, when you have something like this, an automatic procedure, you have to convince people that this automatic procedure would actually do what it's supposed to do. And the easiest way to do it is start here and use the optimizer to solve on each of these dates and follow your portfolio over these dates. And you want to see that the portfolio was better than what he had during the past and better in terms of the statistics that he's going. This is something that is called backtesting. So you perform it in the past, looking forward to optimize it and get on. And that's actually it. How did I do in terms of time? How much time?
One more minute.
One more minute? Oh, excellent. I was kind of worried that I would overshoot or not have enough to talk about. So thank you so much, but please, questions. Yeah. What we're doing we'll dive into the financial instruments. So it would be, as I said, a crash course in financial mathematics. We'll discuss what is a bond, what is an option, what is interest rate future. The reason for that is, in order for me to discuss what probability model to assign to certain variable, I need to say what the variable is. And in order for me to say how the variable is derived, what actually this variable represents, I need to speak about financial instruments. And we'll start from there. We'll start, what are the financial instruments, what are the risk driver, or what are the variables that actually can be modeled with a probability model, and then discuss the data that is actually used.
You were talking mostly about the risk assessments and the risk mitigation, and in the end you mentioned that this software should be able to suggest to the people working with the portfolios to choose something which is optimal in terms of risk and performance.
Yes.
What do you do with the performance analysis? How do you that's
a very good question, actually. There are the usual way, the most basic way is to actually take the expected return over the past. So the expected return of a given stock would, the hope is that looking back, let's say for the last year and taking the average, would be a good expected return over the next day. Now, unfortunately, that doesn't work really well in practice. And people have come up with various models for actually defining the expected return of a stock. Because if you know the expected return, you don't really need to look at risk. If I know that, not the expected return, but the true return of a stock, I don't really need to look at risk. I can just trade on that information, but you kind of don't have that info. So you build a model for expected return, and we usually take it as a exogenous data point. We import it and use in that. But if we start with the expected return, let's say the average to be sure, we also have a few models that are based on, I don't know, Black Litterman is a good example of that. It's a model that takes into consideration the expected return, some views that you might have. Say, for example, you believe that IBM would outperform Apple with 3%. That's a nice view for you to have, actually. And black letterman is a good way to actually incorporate this information into the model, and we actually can use that into the optimizer afterwards. So we're going to optimize based on that. But it's not something that we are really concerned in the risk management space as such, the expected return. For the optimizer, it's important, but we allow our clients to actually supply that information for us. Any other questions? Okay. So thank you very much for your attention, and see you in an hour.
Okay.
2 hours. Okay.
This program is brought to you by AUBG Talks. For more, please visit us at aubg.edu/talks.